I welcome you into this worship service. This is a place where everyone's welcome, nobody's perfect, and all things are possible. And I pray that you'll be blessed and God will be glorified by what we do here today. Now, this is All Saints Sunday, and we will remember those members of our church who have gone on to be with the Lord over the past 12 months. And you'll notice in the order of worship, there is a litany of saints. And when it comes time for the litany, I'm going to have the communion elder, Tom Smith, will be here, and he will light this candle. This candle has gone on to be with the Lord. Hopefully, Tom's going to do a better job with this than I. He will light this candle from this candle on the communion table. And as we read the litany, as we say the person's name, a family member or a friend is invited to come forward. And as we say that name, to light a candle in honor and memory of that person. So Tom will give you the candle. And then when you light the candle for your loved one, you give it back to Tom. Then you go back to your seat, and then we will go through the entire litany. The last line of the litany, there is a blank. And that is so you can say the name of a friend or a loved one who has died this past year, and Tom will light a candle in honor and memory of them. Tom, be careful with the candle. It's not cooperating. And on the first Sunday of every month, we celebrate the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. And we have open communion. We invite all Christians, regardless of denominational affiliation, to share in this special moment with us. You'll be invited to come forward one row at a time. One of the ushers will let you know when it's your time to come. I'll be standing down here with the bread. Tom will be over here with the juice. I will give you the bread. You will take it. You will go to Tom. Take the cup. Drink it. You put the empty container in that little basket on the front pew and then go back to be seated. If you're not able or not comfortable coming forward, after everyone has come forward, I will ask, has everyone been served? And if you raise your hand, Tom and I will come to you and serve you. There are also individual packets in the pews that you may use instead of coming forward or having us go to you. Choir is going to rehearse briefly following worship. Oh, we have one birthday this week. Addie Weaver is celebrating her birthday on today, celebrating it today. So happy birthday to Addie. Bethel University Day. Our denomination has one university, and it's in McKenzie, Tennessee. It is called Bethel, the House of God. And this day is set aside. If there is a little flyer that you may have picked up as you came in, tell you about Bethel. If you'd like to make a contribution to our one university, you can make your check out to the church and then on the memo line put Bethel. We make mats for the homeless and more on Monday. Weight Watchers Tuesday at noon. We have a session meeting Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. Elders, there are packets on the secretary's desk in the church office. Intercessory prayer Wednesday at 11. And outreach ministry Wednesday afternoon at 5:15. Friday, and I think it's Friday, is Veterans Day. So if you're a veteran, if you're able to stand, would you stand? If you're not able to stand, would you just raise your hand? We appreciate your service. Chris isn't here. I was going to say something happens on November the 10th, but since Chris isn't here, I won't mention that it's a Marine Corps birthday. Just a reminder about two adult Sunday school classes and a reminder about the Love Loaf program. You will notice an article on the back of your bulletin about it. If you haven't picked up one of the boxes, we invite you to do that as you leave. Just put your change in it. And we will dedicate all the boxes, bring them back on Stewardship Sunday / Thanksgiving Sunday, the 20th. 75% will go to the Harvest Project in Brazil to meet hunger needs. 25% stays locally and will go to Second Harvest Food Bank of East Tennessee. And I know where you are this time. Teresa's going to make a comment about Thanksgiving in October or the Thanksgiving baskets.
The Missions Ministry would like to say a heartfelt thank you to everyone for your support of the Thanksgiving baskets. This past Wednesday, we were able to deliver the food, and the check was mailed. We estimated probably $1,000 in food that we carried, like two truckloads full of food, and a check for $2,155 was sent. So this was awesome. Thank you. Any monies that are not used for the basket will be used at Christmas. Grace Lutheran also sponsors Christmas baskets. And so any monies that we don't, that aren't used there, they'll carry over for the Christmas baskets. So thank you so much.
Are there any other announcements that need to be made? If not, then let us worship God. Our call to worship is taken from John, and I'm going to invite you to participate in the call to worship. You'll read the part that's in bold in the bulletin or yellow on the screen. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?"
"Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God."
Let us pray. Almighty God, with all the saints of every time and place, we come to worship you. We praise your name and rejoice in the wisdom you reveal to us. Fill us with hope, even when we're walking through the valley of shadows. Since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, help us to do good and to show mercy, expecting nothing in return except to glorify you. We pray now for ourselves. We hunger for more than bread. Feed us now with that spiritual food that leads to an abundant life. This is our prayer through the one who came to give us life, life in all its fullness, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Would you stand with me and sing hymn number 1, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God"?
Did we in our wrong?
children are invited to come forward for their special time. We only have one child, and she's afraid to get too close to me. No, honey, I'm kidding. I get Rebecca hugs every morning. That's not a problem. Okay. Hi, Becky. I'm glad you're here. Today is a special day. It's All Saints Sunday. And it's a day when we remember those members of our church and loved ones and friends who have gone on to be with the Lord. And to try to help think about this, illustrate this, I'm going to talk about something C.S. Lewis wrote. He wrote a story called The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Have you seen the movie? Cool, you can help me with this sermon. And The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe starts out where they're in this big mansion, and there are kids playing hide and seek. And it's Lucy's turn to be it. So she runs into this room, and there's only one thing in that room, and it's a big old-fashioned wardrobe, which is kind of like a closet. And this would be a perfect place to hide. So she opens a wardrobe. Inside are all of these coats, fur coats. She loves fur coats. She walks inside the wardrobe, and it smells so good. It feels so good, those fur coats. And then she notices there's another row of coats. So she takes two or three more steps into the wardrobe. There are all of these coats. There are mothballs on the floor. And she keeps thinking she's going to come to the back of that wardrobe. And she keeps kind of feeling her way. And then all of a sudden, beneath her feet, she doesn't feel mothballs, but something is crunching under her feet. And then all of a sudden, it's still night, although that looks like day. She finds herself not rubbing against fur coats, rubbing up against fur trees. And there is this lampstand, and all of a sudden, she finds herself in a place called Narnia. And I think one of the things C.S. Lewis was trying to tell us is that there is this thin veil between our world and the next, just like taking a step out of the wardrobe into Narnia. So when it is our time, we just take this one small step out of this life into the next. And I like that image when trying to understand what John was writing about in the revelation God gave to him, which is where our scripture reading comes in. And John is talking to seven churches. He's writing to seven churches, trying to encourage them. They're going through a very difficult time. And he is trying to tell them about another reality that exists right alongside their reality and what they're doing. And to explain that, have you ever been to a play where people are on stage and they're acting? Well, on stage, there is an upstage that's back and a downstage that's forward. And if you want to show two things happening, maybe at the same time, sometimes what they'll do, they'll put a screen, this little film thing, right in the middle, and it's dark. And if they want to show what's happening downstage, they light that up. They want to show what's happening upstage, they light that up. They want to show what's both happening at the same time, they light up both of them. Well, that's what John is doing. Downstage, we have these seven churches who are having a very difficult time in trials and tribulation and problems that I will speak a little bit more about that in the adult sermon. But he wants them to know at the same time there is this thin veil between our world and the next. And at the same time, there are others who are doing something. And this is what he says they are doing. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." He is saying, there are those right now, they've been through what you've been through. They have been through trials. They have been through the tribulation. They have had problems. Guess what they're doing right now? singing praises to God. Guess what? You're not always going to have this trouble, these trials, this tribulation. One day you're going to pass from this world, and you too are going to be able to sing praises to God. So hold on. Don't give up. And that's what we remember on All Saints Day. Those individuals upstage in that celestial city, in that place we call heaven, and they are singing praises to God right now because He is their salvation. And they are trying to encourage those of us who are still left behind. You just keep holding on. Don't give up. Brighter days are ahead. And we remember the influence that those saints had on our lives. And so that's what I want you to remember. Yeah, they are there. What in Hebrews? Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every sin and weight that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set out for us. And that is God's word for those of us who are left behind as we remember those who have gone on before. Well, let's pray. Can I hold your hand? Yeah. Our Father, we thank you for the saints who have gone on before us, for the saints who are with us now, and most of all, for the gift of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, through whom we pray. Amen. Thanks, Becky. The call to confession is taken from 1 John, where John writes, "If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." So let us do that now. Let us confess our sins together. I invite you to pray with me the prayer of confession. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of guilt. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you now to privately confess your sin to God. Amen. Hear this assurance of forgiveness again from 1 John. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin, but if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. Let us rejoice in this assurance.
Again with me and sing Amazing Grace.
I want.
offertory invitation is taken from Psalm 116. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Let us worship now with the giving of our gifts to God. Gracious God, how can we say thanks for all the things you have done for us, things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for us. The voices of a million angels could not express our gratitude, all that we are and ever hope to be. We owe all to you. Just let us live our lives and let them be pleasing, Lord, to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Our scripture reading is taken from the 7th chapter of the Revelation given to John. And from that chapter, I'll read verses 9 through 17. So I invite you to listen. Listen for the word of God to you. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "These in white robes, who are they? And where did they come from?" I answered, "Sir, you know." And he said, "These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And let us once again go to God in prayer. And as we do, I'll remind you of the prayer concerns printed on the back of the bulletin. Crystal Bolin is having surgery today, so we ask that you lift her up and pray for her. Linda Diggs is evidently recovering well because she is the head usher for the month of November. I told her I thought that was a little ambitious. She ignored me. But we're glad you're here. Glad Betty is here with us as well. We like good news. We like praises. Rust family, these are relatives of Pete and Jessica DeMaster, recently lost their 35-year-old daughter, Charity. So please lift up that family in your thoughts and your prayers. And Kathleen Reniger, Linda Diggs' aunt, passed away on Friday. So remember Linda and the family in your thoughts and your prayers. And Barbara Siegel, Barbara Faye's mother, is not doing well, which is why she's not in worship. They have gone to Las Vegas to be with her mother. So remember that family. If there's anyone that you would like to let us know about, you're invited to say their name out loud as we first go to God silently in prayer. And then I will lead in the pastoral prayer. Let us go to God. Merciful God, you are the source of meaning in life and our hope of victory in death. We bow in gratitude for the ties which bind us to those who have gone before us. We're grateful for the assurance that the end of their journey with us does not mean the end of their journey with you, that their service to you is not limited to the time of their earthly journey, that their influence on us is not buried with them, that in ways they never would have guessed and we never could have planned, they continue to guide us, helping us resist the temptation to do evil and leading us to do what is right. As we think of those who have gone before us, we pray that we may leave a legacy worthy of our calling by Jesus Christ. Now and then we've had visions of it, of the people we might be, that we sometimes dream of being. Here and there we've heard echoes of what our lives together could be as people, as a nation, as family, as a church. We've had our moments. But there is within us so much more of this power than we ever spend, a power that comes from you. Loving God, if we have a long way to go, you know we have also come a long way. As we think of those who have gone before us, we pray that we may leave a legacy worthy of our calling and that the world will be a better place because we have passed through. Hear us now as we pray the prayer Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. There is a prayer concern that I forgot to mention. It was written down. And these are friends of Becky Bullard who are in a car wreck. So we ask that you remember these three individuals, Mike Schaefer, Janie Marshall, and Teresa Carey.
We gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like living flame. For through the living Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. No one is a stranger here. Everyone belongs. Finding our forgiveness here, we in turn forgive all wrongs. He joins us here, he breaks the bread. The Lord who pours the cup is risen from the dead. The one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. We are now a family of which the Lord is head. Through the one seen, he meets us here in the breaking. We'll gather soon where angels sing. We'll see the glory of our Lord and coming King. Now we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord.
There are certain Christian holidays or holy days that we love to celebrate. We love celebrating Christmas, which is only a few weeks away. Advent is going to be here before you know it. This is my favorite season of the year, as all of you know. And we love celebrating Easter, the most important day of the entire year. And we remember with reverence and respect other holy days, Ash Wednesday, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday. Now the world celebrates, we just celebrated, what is called Halloween. But we in the church very often refer to it as All Hallows Eve. And we completely ignore, or almost completely ignore, the holiday or the holy day that All Saints Eve fronts for, which is what? All Saints Day. Now, Halloween doesn't have any impact on Christian discipleship. It has no meaning for Christian discipleship. But remembering the saints of the church, those who have gone on before us, the legacy they have left behind, it is critical for Christian discipleship. And it's important for us to spend this time remembering those who have had a powerful influence on our lives and reflecting on how we're living in light of their legacy. Now the term saint can give us a little bit of difficulty, a little bit of trouble, because there are certain traditions that you have to measure up to certain criteria to be canonized as a saint. There are certain mighty acts, there are certain miracles that need to be performed. But that's not the way it is in the Protestant church in general. That's not the way it was in the New Testament church. In the New Testament church, saints were who? All of those who were Christians. All of those who had surrendered their lives to Jesus Christ. And Paul, he begins his letters to many of the churches this way. Let me share just a few of them with you. He addresses his letter to the Roman Christians, to all God's beloved in Rome who are called to be saints. He greets the Colossians as saints and faithful brothers and sisters. He sends his Philippian letter to all the saints in Jesus Christ who are in Philippi with the bishops and deacons. So amazing, even bishops and deacons, I guess, can be saints. And to the Corinthians. Now this church, and I've said this before, they were torn in divisions, fighting within itself, divided over political and social issues, and he still addresses them as those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call on the name of the Lord. So who are the saints? Frederick Buechner puts it this way: the foolish ones and the wise ones, the shy ones and the overbearing ones, the broken ones and the whole ones, the despots and crackpots of our lives who, one way or another, have helped us toward whatever little we may have or ever may hope to have of some kind of seedy sainthood of our own. So who are the saints? You are. Who are the saints? Those we are remembering today. Absolutely everybody. And Carlisle Marnie remarked that a person is like a house. And he said the living room, okay, of the house, that is where we entertain all of our friends. There is the basement in which we keep all of our trash. And he says that on All Saints Day, this is the time where we go out in the front yard and we turn around and we salute all the balcony people, all the people who have gone on to be with the Lord. In John Bunyan's classic work, Pilgrim's Progress, he goes on to say, we're introduced to two characters, Christian and Hopeful, who are drawing near to the river of death. And as they reach the river, they are met by two shining figures whose raiment shines like gold and whose faces shine as the light. These two shining figures are able to lead Christian and Hopeful as they emerge out of the river of death and into the celestial city. These shining figures are not angels. Rather, they are the saints of God, shining as lights in the world of darkness and sin. And he said, that is who we are to be, shining lights, helping the wanderer find his or her way home. And isn't that what we're remembering today? Who we're remembering today? Those who are shining lights for us, showing us the way to go home. Now, Revelation 7, 9, and 14, I'll just remind you of what I've shared with you before. After this, I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. Now go back. Let this image kind of sink in your mind. Who was there? Everybody, every nation, tribe, people, language, standing before. And I'll talk in a moment about how they get there. There is a member of the church who shared with me about a funeral she attended. And she said, I've got to tell you about this funeral. I've never been to a funeral quite like this before. She said, there were, I've forgotten how many ministers, but at least two ministers were involved, but they gave members who were there, the people who were there, a chance to talk about their friend, their loved one. And she said, and so the funeral lasted a long time. And I've been to funerals like that. You've been to funerals like that. And then when it came time, the two ministers spoke, and one of the ministers didn't really speak about the loved one who had gone on to be with the Lord. He spent almost all of his time trying to evangelize those who were there. And you've been in those services, have you? Now this time is going to come for you. Are you ready for that day? Are you ready for that moment? But this is what struck the church member. This is what really surprised her. Then that minister said, unless you belong to this church, you're not going to heaven. Oh my good. What Bible is he reading? I cannot find that in any translation, in any Bible I have ever read in my entire life. How do we get there? We don't get there by a denomination. We don't get there by a congregation. We don't get there through the sacraments. Just because you're baptized, just because you participate in the Lord's Supper, that's not how you get to the celestial city. How do you get to the celestial city? These are they who have gone out of the great tribulation. And we all have trouble in trial and tribulation, don't we? Things we're not proud of, things we keep in the basement. How do we get there? They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Anybody who says anything else, it's blasphemy. Don't you dare listen to them. And you have my permission to get up and walk out. I might want to say something, but I probably, not in a funeral, I wouldn't. Yeah, I might. No, I wouldn't. That is, you're not saved by correct theology, right? You're not saved by correct doctrine. You're not saved by denomination or religious affiliation. You're saved by what? A personal, dynamic relationship with Jesus Christ. Period. That is it. Okay, what does a saint do? Okay, I told Becky, and I think, and I'm kind of glad Duncan wasn't able to be here. I'm sorry he's sick, Dad. I'm sorry he's sick. But I liked the image of the veil. And what does revelation mean? One of the meanings of revelation is pulling back the veil so we can see what has been hidden. And that is what John is doing, revealing that which is hidden. You've got people rooting for you up there, as it says in Hebrews. You've got people, they went through tribulation too. They went through problems too. They are glorifying God. This is your destiny. This is what is going to happen to you. They fought the good fight. They finished the race. You do the same. This is what Paul says in his letter to Timothy. For I'm already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time for my departure is near. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me. He's going to give it to me. Paul's not going to earn it. Remember, he's the chief of sinners because of what he did before, when he was Saul, before he actually became Paul, which is why I think he thought he was the chief of sinners. No, not forgiven because of his righteousness, but because of the righteousness of the Lord will be given to him on that day. And not only to me, but to you too. But to absolutely all the saints, everyone who has surrendered their life to Jesus Christ, that award, that's what's waiting for you, that which John was describing. They are involved in a holy struggle. Isn't that what we are involved in? Against evil, against the forces that seek to hurt us, to hurt other people. And we're not perfect. But what do? We persevere. We hang on. We fight the good fight. We are surrounded by saints right now in this room. Romans 1:7 and Philippians 1:1. To all God's beloved, and I'm going to kind of read what I read before. In Rome, we are called to be saints. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi. Okay, insert Oak Ridge. Insert to all the saints of the Oak Ridge, of the First Covenant Presbyterian Church of Oak Ridge. I keep getting our name wrong. My mother tried to, you know, find us on YouTube and couldn't because I told her the wrong name. That is not a good idea. So I fixed it. But whatever church you belong to, And the whole point is we're all brothers and sisters, right? I don't care. Okay, I'll get to that in a minute. The message, hold on, stand firm, 16:13 out of 1 Corinthians, be on your guard. There are a lot of things going to try to trip us up. Stand firm in the faith. Don't let anybody pull you away. Be courageous, be strong. Have faith, Hebrews 13:18. In a rapidly changing world, what do I always say? We need islands of stability. We need a foundation that is not going to change. Everything is changing around us. There are times we feel like the world is just falling apart. Okay, I feel like the world is just about to fall apart. Okay, we need a solid foundation. The one thing that does not change, and that is Jesus Christ. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now, the saints have gone on. The ones above and beyond, who are they? Okay, hold on to this thought. Galatians 3:28 and then Revelation back to the scripture reading. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. At the time Paul was writing this, there were divisions. Jews felt superior to Gentiles. Free people were superior to slaves. Males were superior to females. And he says, this is revolutionary. This was radical at the time. Not so in the church. Not so in Jesus Christ. We are all partners. We are all equals, no matter slave, free, Jew, Gentile, male, female. It does not matter. And that is also what John is saying in Revelation. Who's up there? Everybody is up there. And I know the joke is, well, there is one denomination. They're going to be surprised by all the other people who are up there when they get there. Yeah. What is their reward? What is it? Revelation 7:16-17, and then from chapter 21, verse 4. Never again will they hunger. Never again will they thirst. The sun will not beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of living water. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. Let us remember the saints that have gone on before. I'm going to invite Tom, if he would, to come forward. And I'm going to invite the congregation to stand as we read the litany of saints. And as the name of your loved one or friend is called, you're invited to come forward. and light a candle in honor and memory of them. Let us remember those who have gone before, whose souls are in the hands of God. We remember Peggy Googe. Where death and mourning will never touch them. Where crying and pain have passed away, we remember Rick Menifee. Where every tear has been wiped from their eyes, let us remember those who have gone before, whose souls are in the hands of God. May be seated. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's sacrifice until he returns." Let us pray. Most merciful and gracious God, we bow humbly before you in deep gratitude for the most precious gift of all, the gift of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who died to save us from our sins here and now, and to save us eternally. We pray now that you would set apart these elements from all common uses to this holy use in mystery. And this is our prayer, lifted through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. Has everyone been served? I invite you to stand for our closing hymn.
For all the saints who from their labors rest, who thee by faith before the
now Jesus says to each one of you, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Amen.